we're moving on to imaging now. We know what the interferometer measures, the visibility function. We know how to calibrate our interferometer in the first order using uncalibrated sources in the visibility function again. But now we're going to make images out of the visibility function. Now, this lecture focuses specifically on making maps. What you can also do, and what Marissa will get onto tomorrow, is using output from the sum correlator, so the beamformer, to track pulsars. Now that's slightly different, and as you don't have any phases captured by different spacings, you can't reconstruct a full map of the sky. You can only get a power response at a very specific point on the sky, very high spatial resolution and temporal resolution. But okay, for now we're going to move on to making maps. Now, we've already alluded to that we measure spatial frequencies using an interferometer, so spatial coherency measurements. Now, we're going to formalize the relationship between the sky brightness distribution and the visibilities that we measure. This relationship is known as the Van Sittart-Zernike theorem. All right. So at this point, you should you would have seen that we've gone through a Fourier transform, which will come into play now. We've gone through the measurement space, the visibility space. We've gone through the radio interferometric measurement equation, or the RIME, or how we describe all the various different effects that influence our propagating signal. And we have gone through the related calibration, in which we remove those effects using various calibration strategies. All right. Let's just recap for a moment the convolution theorem, because it's going to become very important in this lecture. The convolution, again, just to state the convolution theorem, a convolution in one domain is in one Fourier domain is a multiplication in its opposite domain, right? So if you have a convolution in the visibility space or the grading space, then you can have a multiplication in the image space, for instance, right? So that's just an example. Now, what exactly is a convolution? Let's just recap what that is. Convolution gives you essentially the area under two curves as you slide one of the curves over the other, right? That's very basically what it is. Examples of this will be in computer vision. If you want a blurring operation, you take a function f, which is your image, right? You take another function g, which is your kernel in this case, and that kernel is a simple, can be a simple two-dimensional Gaussian function, and you slide that Gaussian function across the image. So you compute the integral of the function f with the offset function g. And what you're going to get is a blurred image, right? So it's essentially a response of that operation, that sliding operation. Another good example that everybody will be familiar with at this point in time is this 7-day averages that we see in the COVID statistics. You can think of that 7-day average as a sliding mean function, right? So we have a box with an interval of 7 days, and we slide it across our data. That has the effect of smoothing any outliers. So that is another instance of a convolution operation, in essence. Now, what is, I'll show example here, what is the going to be the result of convolving a Dirac delta? So let's say our input signal is a delta function, and the and our kernel here is a Gaussian. So you can think of this as the response of our instrument is a Gaussian function. What is going to be the measured signal? Well, what you're going to get out is a shifted Gaussian in this case. So this is just a very simple example of this. You can provide any kernel under the sun here into this convolution operation. It doesn't need to be a Gaussian, for instance. All right. And then just to recap, in our visibility space, we said that the various interferometric spacings, so given by the various different baselines, right, within the array, acts as a spatial filter on the sky, right? This is very important. So the response of our interferometer is to spatially filter components of the sky. Now, if you have a short spacing, just if we recap this this particular example, if we have short spacing located along the u-axis, then we're going to have a fringe pattern with a long fringe period, right? If you integrate over this fringe across this image, then what you're going to pick up is mostly just a diffuse, very fluffy stuff of this AGN jets of Cygnus A, right? If you increase your baseline length, the fringe becomes more compact, right? Because you're measuring dot product. If you plug it into a cosine or a sine function, the cosine and sine function is going to become more compact, right? So what we're seeing is a compact fringe. Now, if we integrate this fringe over the sky, what we're going to be picking up is mostly the compact structure, so the supermassive black hole in the middle, the line-like structure in the jet, so as it spurts out, it forms some emission trails, so that very fine structure will be picked up. Any very sharp increases or decreases in flux, that stuff is going to be picked up by this spatial sample. All right. So the UV coverage of the array, to recap, long spacing, so this spacing here at the top, right? Those will lie towards the outskirts of the UV domain, right? I'm showing the VLA in its most compact deconfiguration here. The VLA is this telescope in New Mexico, which is on rails. It can be extended all the way up to about 36 kilometers. So this is its most compact configuration, right? You'll use this configuration to image broad-scale emission, of course. So even in this this compact configuration, there's going to be longer spacings than others, right? So they lie towards the outer edge of this UV space. And then the short spacings between the nearest antennas, nearest pairs of antennas, they're going to lie towards the center, the origin of this UV space. As I said before, the short spacings is measuring the broadest of the scales. The longer spacings is measuring the finer of the scales, right? All right, so you can think of this UV space as the spatial frequency space. And as I said, we formalize this, but it is essentially the spatial frequency space. The highest spatial frequencies correspond to the finest scales. All right. Then, as I said, the longer spacings is on the edge. The shorter spacings is on the core here. I'm plotting Westerbork's UV coverage here, where the w-axis is pointing towards declination 90, so towards NCP. You'll see that in the middle here, we measured the DC component, as I said. We're measuring the autocorrelation, so each antenna correlated with itself. That is correlating primarily the noise from the low-noise amplification circuitry with itself. That noise doesn't disappear because it's now correlated noise, and we throw those spacings away for the most part. I should say that they make very good diagnostic tools. So before you even get started, I can show you this, but later on during our tutorial, you would want to look at the autocorrelation powers, because they measure the mean of the sky brightness distribution, and that mean should not change unless you have a very strong transient source in the field, which is really, really unlikely. So if that mean doesn't change, and there is some sudden drop on some on one of the antennas, for instance, then you'll pick it up immediately. And it's something that is really quick to plot. So it's a good diagnostic tool, but we don't use it for interferometric imaging or calibration unless you're doing, unless you're interested scientifically in really broad scale structure, which isn't captured by the spatial frequencies of the interferometer, such as H1 intensity mapping in the galactic plane. That is a special case where you want to keep that autocorrelation product. Or you do it with a single dish, same difference. So the sky here, as I said before, is real, right? So each baseline pair, PQ, or conversely QP, measures the conjugate of the other one. So in this case, they add no further information. So we say that the Fourier transform is their mission, right? So we keep only one set of these tracks, either red or blue, not both. So this is why our data rates scale as n times n minus 1 over two, right? Excluding the autocorrelations, just because we only keep one set, one of these sets. Then you'll see that as you go further out, you have fewer and fewer spacing. So you have fewer and fewer really long spacings in the array, right? They're much harder to construct because you'll need many more antennas for instantaneous good coverage up to long spacings, right? So as you move further out in most arrays, you will see that you're missing many, many more spatial frequency samples, especially, as I indicated here, in this purple direction. Along that direction, we don't have samples. And because we don't have samples in that direction, it will, as you'll see a bit later on, it will broaden the response of the interferometer in that direction in the image plane. Right? This is just because we are more uncertain about the phase and amplitude of the spatial frequencies in that direction. All right, so moving on to how to sample this space correctly. Again, we're going to back to the Nyquist relationship, which says that the spacing in the image plane is going to be given by the longest baseline, so the highest spatial frequency in the UV plane, right? So delta U is the spacing in this UV space, in the spatial frequency space. Delta L is the spacing on the image, the cosine. For a small image, this is roughly just a offsetting angle, right? But that's just a rough approximation in the small field case. Now, if we keep the, so we have a certain number of pixels, so this gives us the relation between delta L and delta U, essentially. Now, we need to be at least twice this, sampling at least this, twice this baseline length, so twice the highest spatial frequency. Typically, though, this is the very lowest limit. We typically oversample the image by a factor of five or more to be able to fit for essentially the components on the image correctly through our deconvolution process. Right? This is quite important. So we don't only sample it like we said, we upsample the problem quite substantially. So that's just something to keep in mind. So now we're going to formalize this Fourier transform relationship that we've been alluding to all along. As I said, this is the Van Sittart-Zernike theorem. It says that the visibility space, so V between antennas P and Q for any arbitrary selection of P and Q, along the UV plane, right, where we have, we're on the UVW not plane, right, is a Fourier transform, right, this is a Fourier transform of the sky brightness distribution as a function of cosines L and M, as we have defined them before, N pointing towards the tracking center of the interferometer itself. Not necessarily the antennas, but the tracking center of the interferometer. Now, this 1 minus L squared minus M squared term here is N, because it lies on the sky sphere, the celestial sphere. And that's just the determinant of Jacobian, because we have converted this double integral from a single integral over solid angle, right? So it's just stems from the calculus. Now, so this Fourier transform relates an image on a plane, on a two-dimensional plane, right? There's no depth to this plane, it's just two-dimensional plane, through Fourier transform, either direct Fourier transform or fast Fourier transform. Fast Fourier transform needs some further spatial filtering, which I'm not going to get into. It's all covered in the radio interferometry, the fundamentals of radio interferometry textbook that we have on our Rhodes University website. So if you're interested, you can go look at it. But in essence, it's a Fourier transform of the visibilities, and you can relate them to and fro. Of course, here we have a continuous integral, right? We're not going to have that in a practical sense, and we'll see what effect that has on the instrument response a bit later on. Okay, This is a set in the visibility lecture is only valid for east-west arrays, right? And I'm going to get onto that just now. There are some convenient approximations that we can use for two-dimensional arrays, such as the VLA or Meerkat or ASCAP, GMRT, whichever is not east-west. All right, so let's get into this. East-west versus two-dimensional arrays. So on the right-hand side here, we have an east-west array. Let's think of this as a subset of Westerbork, for instance, right? It's on a perfectly flat plane, perfectly lined east-west. We have also another array. Let's say this is a subset of the VLA, and we have some east-west spacings, and we have a north-south spacing. I'm neglecting a lot of spacings here. I'm just illustrating the point here. So in a two-dimensional case, here illustrated on the left-hand side in the three-dimensional UVW space, you'll see that the effect of including that north-south spacing there, even if the array is perfectly flat, so perfectly level flat salt bed, as we have with the VLA, then the samples will still lie on different planes within this three-dimensional UVW space. Contrary to that, if we have only east-west spacings, all the measurements lie on a single plane, right? So this is the difference between them, and this is what breaks that Vincetta-Zenica relationship. The east-west array is always going to be, is the inversion process of the visibilities to an image, or conversely, image to visibilities, is always going to be given by a two-dimensional Fourier transform. Now, why is this? Well, we can mathematically state that there is a single linear transform that takes us, that gives us the W component here in relationship with the original L and N cosines. In this case, it will just be a series of rotation matrices, right? So those series of rotation matrices is going to take us from any plane within this UVW space for any sample that is taken by the interferometer back onto the UVW north plane. And in that case, we have this L prime and M prime cosines here, given by these relationships at the bottom. And this is again just a two-dimensional fast Fourier transform. So we can use, that's what we use to construct the transformation, at least in all of our images, because it's just much faster than the direct Fourier transform. Now, wide field effects is directly tied to our coplanar samples. You can think of them as being two sides of exactly the same coin. Why is this? Well, we have non-coplanar samples given by W, right? And we have a direction off, and they multiply by a direction offset from the tracking center of the telescope, where the tracking center here originally points towards unity. So we have a phase here in this case. Excuse me. So in this case, we have this multiplication term here. So as we increase this offset vector from the source of the tracking center, which can be either non-steered or steered to anywhere in the sky, that offset vector is projected onto the baseline. So we get this N term here multiplied by W. Now, the larger the N, so the wider the field of view, the worse this bit of the contribution to the total delay is going to become, right? And conversely, if we don't have W here because we have an east-west array, then this whole term goes to zero. If we have a north-south spacings where that are very, very large, such as the A configuration of the VLA, then this W component is going to be big. So this total contribution of W and N is going to contribute significant phase contribution to this delay term that we measure with the interferometer, right? So in essence, what this does is the WN minus one, as I've shown in the beamformer discussion yesterday, that adds a tilt into our interferometer, right? So we can think of this as if you have these two spacings in one array, then one of them is measuring the sky at while it's tilted, right? So that's if you think of this conceptually back to the shift theorem, then this signal shift, remember this is, we are multiplying by the exponent of this delay 10 year, this is going to introduce now a delay that is dependent on W and N. So it's going to be a direction-dependent smeared response. So you can imagine if you have many, many different spacings, north-south spacings included, then you're going to get various levels of smearing depending on the contributing spacing. So it's really going to become a very big mess in the image. Now, the solution here is approximation, as always. The smaller, if you make this in offset, the maximum in offset that you can possibly have, small, then this term goes away for the most part. Or if you take the change in W into account through either a convolution back in on the visibility space or a multiplication in the image space, so W projection, W stacking, respectively, then this term is also going to go down, right? So more of this I indicate in the book. Right. So an example here, just to give you a real-world example, this is real data taken with the VLA deconfiguration. The response here, where this source is far offset from the center of the image, where we define the center of the image to be the face-tracking center of the telescope, right? This is just the accepted definition. So there is a Fourier shift involved here when you take the Fourier transform. Then what you're going to get for this off-axis source is this horn-like structure along the source, and you'll see that the source is smeared out. Now, that is typical for these wide-field non-coplanar sampling errors, right? If we take into account this WN term, either through faceting, where we split up the sky into these small bits where we can limit the size of each bit, and then stitch them back together. So we essentially split it up with face tier. We make an image for each of these little bits, and we stitch them together onto a single plane. That is known as faceting. That has been the classic implementation for this since time immemorial, since we were the start of apes. So if you do that, then these effects go away. Similarly, if you combine W back in through either W projection, so convolution in the visibility space, or for W stacking, a multiplication into discretized image levels, and then you sum them back together, that's W stacking. If you take it into account through either of that or a combination of that, or if you if you're doing snapshot imaging where all your samples are going to roughly lie on the same plane, not necessarily over time, but for that instant in time, then you are going to be able to correct for the response of the interferometer to this off-axis source, right? And it should look like that. So you can see that that smeared source has now gone back to something that is nice and compact. It's not yet deconvolved. I'm showing you what is called a dirty image, and we're going to get onto that just now. All right. So here are the limits of the applicability of the Vincent-Zenica theorem for two-dimensional arrays. Number one, we assume mutual incoherence of sources, right? If you have multiple sources across various parts of the sky, they're all going to emit, we're going to assume that they emit incoherently, right? Otherwise, we won't be able to differentiate them from one another, right? Source itself can emit coherently, but it's still going to be localized emission, right? Not emission stemming from the entire sky. If this relationship, if this assumption is broken, then everything falls apart. We also say that we work in the far field approximation. Why? The planar, the waves that come that we measure, so the waves that induces the voltages on our telescope, better be planar waves so that we can measure a delay without knowing the distance of the original source, right? So this far-field approximation is very important. We can really only start imaging well beyond the moon and above with Meerkat, for instance, in L-band. It really only works if you have if you're imaging targets that are very, very far away. This is because it's given by the maximum baseline for a interferometer. Remember that we're constructing a virtual aperture, and that virtual aperture depends on maximum baseline. We also assume that the propagation medium is roughly homogeneous, right? Otherwise, things are going to be smeared up and out and have different path lengths and so forth. So it's no longer really measuring a single phase to a source for all the antennas. Then we can only use this for a two-dimensional array if we make a small field approximation, or we take W into account, or we stitch together many, many different snapshot images, or we combine those techniques. So this error term in the phase needs to be driven to zero, right? As I said, coupled with that small field approximation is the coplanar baselines, right? The two sides of the same coin. Yeah. We also make a narrow band approximation, so our bandwidth per channel inside our image needs to be a very small fraction of the total bandwidth of the instrument. And this relationship here needs to hold, right? So this is related back to the maximum separation in the sky multiplied by U and V here in the aperture plane. And then we also make here the integrals, a continuous sampling approximation. If we discard some of these samples, as we would need to do for a practical instrument, then that's going to have an effect on the response of the instrument to any source from the sky. All right. So now moving on to describing the response of the interferometer to the sky source. So now we're going to get to the interferometer's response to a single source on the sky. Ruby already mentioned this. This is called the point spread function, or PSF. Some older literature and some still call it the dirty beam response, right? And why it's dirty, you'll see in just a bit. Now, so practically, if our instrument was infinitely large and the sampling was infinitely precise, so we have sampling at infinitesimal spacings here up to infinity, then given that we've calibrated our instrument and we've taken into account our W contributions here, then the measurement will be exact, right? So there is an exact transform that takes us from visibility space to image, right? Can this be done in practice? Well, no, not really, right? We can only build so many antennas that have some physical size, right? We can't overlap the antennas, for instance, and we can't build them up to infinity, right? So the missing spacings here, as I indicated on the UV space previously, is essentially going to give us a response pattern, which is this point spread function or dirty beam, for your image, for your instrument size and sampling. Right? Mathematically, we say it's the Fourier transform of the sampling function. So the sampling function is, again, going to be said to be unity where there is a sample and zero where there isn't a sample. So where there is no current distribution from any mirror, right, onto a receiver, we define it to be zero, right? So as we had for the gradient function previously. So mathematically, this response of the interferometer, and I note here the interferometer, not the antennas themselves, the antennas themselves add a further modulation onto this, but the response of a perfectly illuminated series of antennas will, in such an interferometer, gives us, it's a Fourier transform of that sampling function. So that gives us the response. So this is a problem for all instruments. It doesn't necessarily only apply for radio telescopes and radio interferometers in particular. If you look at images of Hubble, for instance, and you have strong stars, then you'll see those classic cross-like patterns on those stars, right? That is not physical at all. That is the response of the Hubble mirrors to that star. So it's not only affects us, but it affects us more because we are missing many, many more samples. So here's some example, and this is great to Rick Birdie. This is the VLA with various subsets of spacing selected. So only we select only three antennas here that gives us three baselines. As we increase this, you'll see that this increases roughly quadratically. As we said before, it's half of that quadratic scaling roughly. So with only three antennas, we measure only very few fringes, right? And they're all roughly at the same spacings here. So again, we're plotting both you can think of the red and the blue bits here. So both the conjugate terms here, right? We typically throw half of them away, but we're just plotting both here. If we only have those antennas, then we can't really localize the source very well, right? So the source can be at any peak here in this Fourier transform of that sampling function, right? So we cannot really say where a single source is here using just those spacings. As we increase those spacings with more and more and more antennas, the instantaneous localization ability of the instrument is much improved. So at the point where we have 27 antennas, there's maximum of 27 antennas available in the VLA, this gives us 351 unique spacings. And at that point, you can see that a response to a point-like source on the sky will have remaining side lobe structure to it, but there is going to be a maximum here. And at this point, we have, to a reasonable extent, localize the bright sources in the field. But later on, we're going to get onto the deconvolution and removing these side lobe structures so that we can also see the fainter sources in the sky, because they're going to be buried underneath these side lobes from the bright sources. But this is the instrument's response to a source, to a single point-like source in the sky. In the first order approximation, this instrument response is going to be constant across the sky. Once you go beyond the full width maximum of the telescope of the antenna, though, then the antenna is going to add both temporal and frequency modulation to the total response of the entire system. So in that case, the direction this point spread function becomes direction dependent, right? And another case which can drive direction in the direction dependence of the PSF is if you've averaged your visibilities too much and you're interested in a source very far away from the stopping center. Remember that the fringes of that source is going to be washed out by that sync function, as we discussed yesterday. So we're going to see a drop in amplitude for those sources, and they're going to be smeared out physically in size a bit. So the response of the total instrument towards that source is a smeared out response. And again, the point spread function becomes direction dependent. And this very much complicates accurate deconvolution. But yeah, that is a more advanced topic. Now, say we only have these 27 VLA antennas. We don't have money to construct any more antennas. How do we go about improving the array's QV coverage? Well, since the interferometers measure Fourier modes, measuring more and more modes will, of course, give us better reconstruction, as we just saw. Now, there are many ways to improve this coverage. So one here is, as I said, as the Earth rotates, because W is dependent on this hour angle, we're going to be rotating the baselines underneath the sky, essentially, right? So what we're going to measure is different spatial coherency projection measurements. The emphasis here is on projection, right? So as the Earth rotates underneath the sky, we measure more and more projected spatial coherency, so the spatial frequencies. So this process was used very successfully by Martin Ryle and his colleagues when they did those very early Cambridge surveys of the sky. Now, so these longer observations, so on the left-hand side, we have a short snapshot point-and-click style observation of 5 minutes on the VLA. The instantaneous coverage looks like that. The instantaneous response to any source looks like that. If we increase the time that we observe the sky for, right? So we have many, many more integration intervals for each of these unique spacings in the array. Then you'll see that these tracks start, well, they start tracking out in ellipses, in general case, paths along this UV space, right? And you can see that the response becomes more and more and more improved, right? So if you have a very long track, I think this one on the rightmost side, if I recall, this is 12 hours. So over a 12-hour period, you get nice continuous tracks with many, many, many samples, and you'll see that the array has now localized the source really well for any given source in the sky. And the side lobe structure that is there, because we are missing some samples here, is very much diminished from what it was from a snapshot observation. So the other way to improve this UV coverage is to use the fact that the UV coordinates are measured in terms of wavelength, right? So by observing at multiple wavelengths, so if we have a large bandwidth, total bandwidth of the instrument, then we can improve that UV coverage even further. And this is a radial scaling, right? For every sampling point here, for this instantaneous measurement, because we're observing at a wide bandwidth, we have essentially many different spatial frequency samples here for every such time sample, right? And this further improves the UV coverage, right? So these are the two primary ways of filling the UV plane, aside from building more antennas, right, which is really not practical. Then once we've combined all these various Fourier modes, right? So at this point, we have a whole bunch of samples. So we have these in number of baselines by number of integration times the number of channels worth of samples here. Then at that point, we combine them in a single Fourier transform. Now remember that the Fourier transform is additive, it's a linear transformation. So we can either take the Fourier transform of each of these samples, which each of them are just a fringe of some spacing, and we can combine them into an image, right? And that will give us the response of all of the samples, or equivalently, we can combine all of these samples onto a grid, and we can take the fast Fourier transform of that. So that's going to be equivalent, provided that we also add some filtering to that process. I'm not going to go into the details of that. But what you're going to get out, as I said, from all these various spatial frequency samples is the instrument's response, as we've just shown it. Now, if we have only the short spacings in the array, such as the VLA deconfiguration, so we're interested in doing H1 science, for instance, and we've selected the VLA deconfiguration as the optimal configuration for our science, then the PSF response is going to be broad, right? Right. So as we only have coarse spacings, we have a sensitivity to only broad like scales in the sky. Now, this is optimal for observing broad scales. So let's say we are observing Donald Duck sitting and quacking on Polaris here at declination 90, then what we're going to see in the dirty map is just the very broad scale features of Donald Duck, right? And this is with the VLA in deconfiguration simulated here. Now, if we move the antennas further apart up to this maximum of about 36 kilometers, then we have many longer spacings, and those spacings are sensitive to fine scale structures, right? So the PSF response is going to be very narrow, right? You probably don't see this in this slide, but there's a very, very narrow response here, like a point-like response to as a PSF. Now what we're going to see is only the edges of the duct. Now, as those as there are still side lobes in this response, we don't have perfect sampling coverage, then we're still going to see side lobe structure here. And the goal in image is to clean the dirty duct. And this is why we say something, why you say the response to a source just given through this Fourier relationship is a dirty response, right? So this is why we refer to the initial image as a dirty image. So the goal is to remove all of these side lobe structures that stem from the lack of spacings in our interferometer and to get only the actual emission out without all of those side lobe structure. Right? So that is the goal of imaging here. So it's twofold. It's also a process of deconvolving those side lobe structures. Now, there's various ways of skinning the cat here. The most widely used algorithm that's been used since time immemorial, really, is the Hochbaum clean algorithm. There are some variants on this that is more sensitive to multiple scales. So not just a single scale, but multiple scales. There's also multi-frequency clean, which is just a variant that takes into account the source spectra while cleaning. Right, so there is variations on this theme, but they're all on the same theme. So let's look at the most basic example here. So this is the original algorithm. So what we assume here for this algorithm is that the sky consists roughly of many, many small number of, compact sources. Yeah. So as long as the sources are separated, right? So there is some number of sources on the sky, right? It's not some contiguous distribution of sources. So small is just referring to there are visibly discrete sources on the sky that we can see. This is a reasonable approximation to make if you work especially in extragalactic astronomy, right? So just observing compact AGNs very far away from us. Now, we have those sources and an otherwise empty field that just has some noise in it. Because of our instrument, right? Now, the algorithm goes as follows. We find the peak strength of a source, right, in this initial dirty map. Let's call that residual map zero. So this is the peak is giving us the greatest absolute intensity in this dirty image or residual zero. From that, we subtract at the position which we found the peak, a scaled version of the PSF. So let's say the PSF scaled to 10%, right? So it will now have a peak strength of 0.1, right, instead of 1. Normally the PSF is defined to be unity at its peak strength. So at that position, we subtract the scaled PSF, and then we keep a list of those peak fractions along with their pixel positions, so their positions on the sky. So we repeat this process and go back to the next one, and the next one, and the next one, and we gradually subtract out the response of the PSF through this process, up to some point that is user-defined. So let's say the peak is now 5 times the remaining noise. Then we stop. So that's just one example. There's other ways of stopping it, but that's one example. Now, at that point, we do a painting operation. Essentially, this is a glorified painting operation. We convolve the accumulated point source model, which, remember, we keep this list of peak fractions here, and we accumulate onto that list continuously for this process. We convolve that list now to a idealized clean beam. And that is just done by fitting essentially, for the most part, a Gaussian function to the primary lobe of our PSF. So it's a really dirty operation, to be honest with you, but it does work quite well because that primary lobe reasonably approximates a Gaussian function. So it works okay. And then we add the unclean bits, so the noise and the stuff that we haven't cleaned, or we haven't deconvolved through this clean process back into this restored, back into this model convolved map. And that gives us the clean or the restored image. Now, to give you just an example here, let's start with a true sky, right? So let's start with a realized sky. It has 3-point-like sources here of various intensities. There is some systematic noise here. That noise is perfectly Gaussian here. Then, because we're missing spacings here in our UV coverage, we have idealized point spread function here. So our dirty beam looks like this. This is just for example, of course, but let's go through this thought exercise. So our idealized response looks like that. And now what we're going to get out is the dirty image, right? Because what we're in essence doing is what we're measuring in the UV space is the visibility function, right? So that is just the Fourier transform of the sky, right? But we're measuring it at discrete points, right? So we're measuring it in at various Dirac functions within this UV plane that we haven't filled up quite properly. Now, that multiplication with that series of Dirac functions, where each Dirac function lies at the point where we have a spatial coherency measurement. So if we have that multiplication in the visibility space, we're going to have a convolution in the Fourier space if we transform all of that back. And that gives us the dirty image, right? So it's just the true sky, if you've calibrated everything properly, so there's no calibration errors remaining yet. Perfect instrument. We have some true sky out there that we're trying to measure with some noise. We're convolving it with the instrument response, and we get out the dirty map that looks like that, right? So it's just response convolved in with each of these point sources. It will also serve to correlate noise to some level. So what we have left over is not quite Gaussian noise anymore, and it's quite important to realize that. So for a clean example here, we start off with this residual zero map, the dirty image, and we systematically remove the side lobes of the PSF by subtracting it out bit by bit. And what we're left at the residual I image is just some correlated noise with low-level structure from the PSF. So if we started off with true sky like this, what we attempt to reconstruct is that sky without the noise, right? So that is rough. This is what clean will give you at the end. So it's not quite perfect, but it's some approximation of the model. If we have very broad scale emission and things, then things start breaking down, of course. What we're assuming is point-like emission across the field. Now, let's go to a physical example. This is the D2 image that Justin has referred to previously in his lecture, and we've referred to a few times by now. This is the dirty map from that image, from that patch of sky. I've only included 16 antennas here, and it's only 4-hour observation, so the PSF is really not that great because we don't have many sampling points here, but you can see the side lobe structure of the PSF very prominently here. It's most prominent on the AGN on the sky, which is the brightest components in when you work in continuum radio in the extragalactic field. Then you'll mostly measure AGN emission, right? At a lower level, you'll start measuring star formation, but that's at the really fainter level. I would say the 10 to 100 millijansky level, where the AGNs can go, which are also are calibrated, for instance, can go up to several jansky. So it's a few orders of magnitude difference there. So after you've taken this dirty image from a calibrated instrument, you get a map like this through this process of deconvolution. And now you can see that you've started picking up these fainter emission that lies well below the side lobe structure of this dirty map that was convolved with the PSF. All right, so the limitations of the clean algorithm I know it's 5 minutes left here. I just want to go through this quickly. The limitations here is we're assuming a sky consisting just by of point sources. Can we deal with diffuse emission or fields of lots of sources? Yes, but not optimally. So as our telescopes and techniques become more sophisticated, we become more and more sensitive to very rich fields, then we really need to start improving our deconvolution process, and research coming to this specifically. Now that brings us to the final thing, and that is weighting. Now, radio interferometric arrays are made by averaging, essentially, or the images are made by averaging Fourier modes, as we said. For any given array, such as Meerkat, do we have an homogeneous density of these Fourier modes while we're sampling? And could it be desirable for us to use a weighted average rather than a simple average in constructing this Fourier transform? Well, first answer is no. We have many, many more short baselines typically. Take, for instance, Meerkat. About 75% of the antennas lie within a kilometer radius of the origin. So we are going to be biased towards measuring broad-scale emission with that array. So we only really sample many small UV values, and not the larger UV values. Well, could we adjust this averaging method? Well, sometimes it really depends on your goal. As I said, for extragalactic work, you want the resolution, so you would want to do this. So here I show unweighted unweighted sampling while we are constructing images. So here we see that for a coordinate configuration such as we have with Meerkat, everything is going to be biased towards the larger scale. So it's going to be biased towards lower resolution, right? But this gives us optimal sensitivity because we haven't thrown away any information. Going all the way to the other end of the spectrum, we have uniform weighting, and this is just the place where, or just a, just describing where we're weighting each spatial frequency sample with the number of samples in its local vicinity. So in this case, what we're going to get is we're going to be downweighing essentially all those core spacings that we have so many samples of, and we're going to be by doing this, we're going to be essentially upweighing the longer spacings where we don't have many samples, and this makes the instrument less biased towards the towards broad scale emission, and more optimal for work for doing science in, for instance, extragalactic fields, so AGNs that are really far away, for instance. But we do this at the cost of sensitivity because we are throwing away the core spacings essentially by doing this process. So is there a silver bullet here? Well, there is, and that is this Briggs or robust weighting scheme. This is named after the late and great Daniel Briggs. So this is just a sliding scale with a single parameter that takes you from uniform weighting to natural weighting. This robustness parameter, as we call it, of zero here gives us a roughly reasonable good trade-off between sensitivity and resolution, right? So at roughly -2, you are close to uniform, so you've slightly exceeded uniform for if you image with WSClean, DD facet, or CASA, then -2 is tending towards a super uniform weighting. And +2 is close, on the other hand, is close to natural. This is slightly different from the parameters that you'll see if you use APES or OBIT. Then that sliding scale goes from -5 to 5, but that is really just a technicality. That's just a slight change in definition, but it really doesn't matter. To conclude, I'm showing here the response at various different robust values of robustness of the Meerkat array as it currently stands, our 64-element array. You'll see that at uniform weighting, we have this nice compact response to any source from the sky, but we have strong side lobes, so we typically don't image at this robust factor as a final imaging step, for instance. What we typically do is image between about minus 0.3 and 0, which gives us a nice Gaussian-like response for the primary lobe and very low side lobes. However, I should note that because the meerkat array is distributed roughly Gaussian in the core and then have another Gaussian distribution at the edge, if we add those two Fourier transform of those two Gaussian distributions, what we're going to get is essentially a top hat structure. And it's really not ideal for imaging. This, I'm going to blame on the pulsar scientists here. They use they rely heavily on the core, but it's really not great to have this kind of configuration for imaging. But we have to work with what we have, unfortunately. There's various different priorities. So in this case, you would need to either taper off the short spacings or you would need to taper off the long spacings and before you can make an image, because you really do not want to halfway deconvolve a source with a response like this and get some broad scale flanks left over in your residual and then add back the source here. That will appear as if you have broad scale extended fluffy stuff amongst your bright AGN components, for instance, if you're doing cluster sciences, and that is really not ideal. I'm going to end off here, and the next I'm going to describe is self-calibration, but this is only tomorrow.